Welcome to Lifelong Running, the channel where we help you run smarter, faster, and injury-free. Today, we're going to take a look at supershoe research, what's been going on in recent times to help you make the best decisions when you spend that $275 for a pair of racing shoes. Today is Halloween, so got my French crown jewels here. I hope they do find them. We got to go to Paris last year for the Olympics and take a tour through the Louvre, and I do remember seeing those. So hopefully they get returned and I'll have a different costume next year. You may remember back in 2017 is when the Nike Vaporfly was first released, and we saw numbers around 3 or 4% lower energy cost in running, comparing those to Nike and Adidas racing flats at the time. Now, there's been a lot of research and a lot of developments and changes that have happened since then. So let's just go through a list of some of the things that we know now that weren't fully understood at the time. One of the early questions was whether they work just as well uphill, downhill, and on level ground. We had an interesting discussion with Jared Ward after he got sixth in the New York Marathon in 2018 wearing his super shoes. And he felt like uphill was not quite as good, downhill felt great, and level also felt really good. So we did a little study to figure out, are we getting the same metabolic savings no matter what grade we're on? And the answer came across as yes, they do work equally well no matter what the grade is, at least +4 through -4 is the investigation that we did. So whether you're going uphill or downhill or level, they are still going to be effective for you. We just had an article accepted that will be out there available to read in just a hopefully a couple more weeks. And it looked at whether these shoes, let's say they start with a 3% metabolic benefit when you're at the beginning of a run. We had them run for a full hour and looked at the energy cost throughout that run to see if that benefit grows, decreases, or stays the same. And on average, what we saw is there was an increase in the benefit that these shoes give. Both shoes that we had people run in led to an increase in energy cost as the run progressed for various physiological reasons, but there was a bigger increase in this energy cost in the control shoes that we used. We used the Saucony Kinvara compared to the Endorphin Pro 3. So the shoes seem to help you the longer the run goes in terms of how much energy it will require to run. The next area we're interested in was trying to figure out where do these energy savings come from. We would assume that some muscles are getting activated less if we're using less energy to run. So we took a look at various muscles of the leg to find out, is it around the hip or knee or ankle where the muscles are working a little bit lighter? And what we found is all the muscles were working exactly the same in terms of muscle activation other than gastrocnemius and soleus. So the calf muscles, those were taking a smaller amount of activation when we were running in super shoes. The ankle does actually produce a lot of force or torque around the ankle in running. The certain speeds, you'll actually see the ankle creating greater torques than any of the other joints in the body. So the ankles do produce a lot for us when we're running, and if we can save some energy there, that's going to turn out to be quite substantial. We'll do some further research in this area to figure out exactly what's going on between the conditions, and there's other professors and researchers around the country that are also investigating this question. Now, with that in mind, you should realize if you do a lot of training in super shoes, then your ankle or muscles around the ankle are maybe not working quite as hard. So they're going to detrain a little bit. So if you just do a small amount of training and racing in super shoes, it's probably a very small issue there. But if you spend a lot of time in those, and some of the trainers now are using parts of the components of super shoes, then you should probably add some stimulus to your gastroc and soleus in the weight room, or however you can do that with the intent to keep your gastroc, soleus, and Achilles tendon strong and healthy. Question I've often been asked is if the shoes are actually just a placebo effect. Now, they're so dramatically different, that seems highly unlikely, but there was an interesting study that came out in 2025. Here it is to take a look at. And they had super shoes and what they called a placebo shoe or a control shoe that was spray painted black, and they were told this is some knockoff brand. And even though the metabolics and the movements and everything were exactly the same, they did find that there was some kind of placebo effect within the person where they felt that they were getting a performance benefit and just enjoyed running in the shoe more. So there may be some psychological things going on, but I'm convinced that the primary factor of why people run faster is because of the effective of the shoes and how they drop that metabolic cost through working really effectively. The final part for us to think about today is, why do the shoes work? What exactly is it about them? We found that when the plate is cut through, this article by Healy and Hoogkammer, they found that when they cut the plate and then the shoe became much more foldable, that there was just as good of a benefit to the person as when the plate was fully intact. So those thoughts early on of these carbon fiber plates are working as springs that are helping the person, that doesn't seem to be the case. The plate does need to be in there. We found that it holds the foam together more effectively, adds some stability to the shoe, but in terms of the bending stiffness, that doesn't seem to be anything that's really critical to the shoe. We're trying to find out some other answers. I've got these shoes here to show you. We've got what's called a hole effect sensor on the bottom of the shoe, one here and one here. And inside the shoe, under the insole, we have a couple of flat magnets. And as that magnetic field grows, as the foam compresses, we get a reading back to our little device here that tells us, once we convert it to millimeters, so the field strength as it compresses, grows, and that tells us how many millimeters of foam there are between the sensor and the magnet. So we're trying to figure out, maybe it's something in how the people load the foam and then the foam pushes back on the person that may explain why some people get more of a benefit, some people get less, and hopefully will it help us understand better what it is in the shoe design that makes it really effective. So keep an eye out for that. As we get into the next few months, we'll be finishing up a study there. If you have some interest in it and you're in Provo, reach out to me so that we can get you included in the study. So if you're making the decision of, should I buy some super shoes for an upcoming race, it comes down to, how much do you care about the time? So it almost sounds like we're buying time, but this is what shoes are by the rules now. So if you want to be as fast as you can and compete with other people that are wearing them, then you probably do need to buy them. We know they work very effectively. We've learned a lot over the last few years of what's going into the shoe and how they can be improved even further. So they'll keep getting better and sticking within the rules.